Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. And welcome to another episode of our series Towards Understanding Surah Yusuf. I am your host, Yassir Qadhi. In our previous episode, we had begun to lay the foundations for understanding the context into which Surah Yusuf was revealed. In today's episode, we will continue along the very same discussion and inshaAllah ta'ala begin a short summary of the themes of the surah. Stay with us.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب ما كان حديثا يفترى ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه وتفصيل كل شيء وهدى ورحمة لقوم يؤمنون.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala, amma ba'd. We are continuing in our discussion of understanding this beautiful surah in the Quran, Surah Yusuf. And in our previous episode, we had begun to talk about the context into which the surah was revealed, and we mentioned the fact that it was a very distressing time for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Meccans had increased in their opposition against him, had refused to accept this religion from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and had begun to basically exacerbate the situation and to continue their persecution of the early Muslims. Added to that, the primary political mentor, the political protector of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the senior most authority and figure in the life of the Prophet ﷺ as an elder, his uncle Abu Talib, had passed away. And shortly after that, within 6 weeks of the death of Abu Talib, this was followed by an even more personal loss, an even closer loss, and that was the death of his beloved wife Khadija. We said that the Prophet ﷺ then decided to undertake a journey to the city of Al-Ta'if and to try basically new ground, fertile ground, and to see whether the people of Ta'if would possibly be interested in this new religion. And so he undertook this rigorous and long journey. It was not long in terms of distance, but it was rigorous because the city of Al-Ta'if is a mountaintop city. It is a city that rests on top of the neighboring mountains of Mecca. And even in our times, when we go to the city, it is a very winding and torturous road up by the through the mountains to get to the city. And whoever has visited the city really and truly can understand, imagining the Prophet ﷺ walking up to the top of the city, where in our times it takes an hour and a half by car, going up and up the winding roads in a very dangerous and a very sloping the mountains of Ta'if. Yet the Prophet ﷺ undertook this journey by himself, walking all the way to the top of the city, only because he wanted to spread the message of Islam, hoping that the people of Ta'if might be more receptive to the teachings than the people of Mecca were. However, to summarize what happened at Ta'if, the Prophet ﷺ was rejected extremely brutally and extremely sarcastically. And one hadith will make us understand the impact that this incident had upon the Prophet ﷺ's psyche. And that was that when Aisha, his beloved wife radiallahu ta'ala anha, asked him, "O Messenger of Allah, was there any day that was more painful to you than the day of Uhud?" And the day of Uhud was the day when he was physically wounded, when his molar teeth were removed, when a javelin or a spear was stuck inside his very cheek, a day when blood spilled from his very face, a day when so many of his beloved, including his uncle Hamza, had died as shaheed. This was the day of Uhud. And Aisha thought this was the worst possible day in the life of the Prophet ﷺ. So she said, "Was there any day worse than Uhud?" And he said, "Yes, the day of Ta'if." The day of Ta'if, he himself, by his own testimony, he himself told us that this was the single most traumatic and most difficult experience of his life, the rejections that he faced from the people of Ta'if. And again, to summarize, we do not have time to go into all of the details. That is for another series of episodes. But for this talk, to summarize the context into which Surah Yusuf was revealed, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approached the leaders of Ta'if, and they happened to be three brothers. When their father died, who was the chieftain, they agreed they're not going to fight and bicker. The three of them together will rule the city of Ta'if. So when he approached these brothers, he told them about his message, he told them about the teachings of Islam, and he asked them to embrace it and help him spread this message. But the three of them rejected him in the utmost of contempt and sarcasm. One of them said, "Has Allah Azza wa Jal not found anyone more worthy than you to be a prophet? A'udhu billah." Another one said, "I am not going to speak to you." Why? He said, "Because if you're a liar, then you are too ignoble for me to speak to. And if you are truthful, then you are too noble for me to speak to." In other words, he's being sarcastic. He's being extremely contentious. Either way, I am not worthy of speaking to someone of your stature. So he's ridiculing and he's making fun of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Not only did they reject him with the utmost contempt and ridicule, they then sent the slaves and the riffraffs of the city to physically pelt him with stones, to physically persecute and torture him. And the Prophet ﷺ had to flee for his very life down the mountain. And the story continues in other books of Sirah, where he made a beautiful dua, and the angel came and said, "O Prophet ﷺ, if you want, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has willed that you may destroy the city by the command of an angel, and you may crush the people of Ta'if between two mountains. And if you want, it is up to you what you want to do." And so the Prophet ﷺ chose to forgive, and he said, "I hope that, inshallah ta'ala, if they reject, perhaps their children will accept Islam." And that is exactly what happened. But the point is that the incident of the city of Ta'if was the single most traumatic incident in the entire life of the Prophet ﷺ. So we find then that in the context of relation, a number of things to understand. First and foremost, the length of time that he has been calling and preaching in Mecca, and he does not receive a positive and a full response from his own people. He faces persecution and torture, and much has occurred in Mecca itself, which we do not have time to get into, but physical torture and mental torture, attempts to discredit him, to ridicule him, to make fun of him, accuse him of the worst crimes. And we see this in Surah Yusuf as well, when the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam is tempted, he is tortured, he is rejected by his own brothers and people, and he is accused of crimes he did not commit. We see all of these themes recurring in the tafsir of Surah Yusuf. Similarly, we notice the loss of loved ones. The Prophet ﷺ's uncle, Abu Talib, and the Prophet ﷺ's wife, Khadija, die. And we notice in the tafsir of Surah Yusuf that Yusuf alayhi salam is, even though his father does not die, meaning that in his lifetime that we know, but he is departed or he is separated from his father. And he is not able to enjoy the love and comfort that he would otherwise have enjoyed. There is a traumatic scenario where the families themselves are split apart. Also, the rejection that the people of Ta'if gave him. Well, if the people of Ta'if rejected the Prophet ﷺ, verily the very blood brothers of Yusuf rejected him. And the very blood brothers of Yusuf attempted to persecute and even tried to kill him. If the people of Ta'if did this to the Prophet ﷺ, verily Yusuf ﷺ also suffered much in his life. So we understand the context of revelation. Now, this is a general context. However, there are also specific incidents that occurred that precipitated the revelation of Surah Yusuf. And this is what we call the science of asbabun nuzul, or understanding the reason why a verse or a surah came down. And this is an important topic in understanding the sciences of the Quran. Asbabun nuzul tells us the specific situation that caused the revelation of a verse or a surah. Exactly what happened so that the surah came down. And there are two specific reasons, two specific scenarios. What we have talked about before is the general scenario, and that helps us understand. But there are two very specific incidents that occurred that, as a response to these situations, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Yusuf. The first of these was that the people of Mecca went to some of the Jews of Medina. Now, there were no Jews in Mecca. There was a group of Jews in Medina. There were no Jews in Mecca, and the Prophet ﷺ did not have any contact with them while living in Mecca. But there were a number of tribes in Medina, and the Quraysh considered the Jews to be a learned civilization and culture. They considered them to be a people who had a scripture and revelation, and this is true. They considered them to be superior in terms of civilization, in terms of reading and writing, and this too is true, because the Jews had a book and many of them could read and write. Whereas the pagan Arabs, like most pagan religions, they did not have a holy book, and most of them could not read and write. And so there were a number of times that they went to the Jews, attempting to find information to discredit the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They wanted information they didn't have. They wanted a perspective they could not have because they were a pagan nation. They were a nation steeped in idolatry. They didn't have a revelation from God. So they went to the Jews and they said, "Can you tell us how to outwit this man? How to show that he is not a prophet of God?" So the Jews said, and they said many things, and many of them were the causes of revelation for other surahs and verses. But of the things they said, ask him about Yusuf alayhi salam. Ask him about Yusuf and the people of Yusuf, and the story of Yusuf, and the brothers of Yusuf. And if he is a prophet, he will respond. And if he is not a prophet, he will not be able to respond to you. So this was a question that was asked to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam by the Quraysh, that came from the Yahud. The second cause of revelation was that the companions themselves began to ask the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "O Messenger of Allah, why don't you tell us stories from the people of the past? In other words, we want to hear the trials and tribulations of the previous generations. Why don't you tell us qasas? Why don't you tell us stories?" And so as a response to this, Allah reveals in the Quran that نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ, we reveal to you the best of all stories. And it is human nature, that human nature wants to hear stories. Look at our children. When we put them to sleep, what do? We tell them a bedtime story. They love to listen to stories. It inspires them. It gives them morals. It gives them a world that existed before. Whether it's a true or it's a fable, it doesn't matter. The children's imagination works and it begins to think of other things and other civilizations, other cultures. Even as an adult, there's an element that every one of us loves to hear. And that is why we love to hear stories. That is why even the Quran has so many stories in it. But the stories of the Quran, of course, are true stories. They are stories of actual events that have benefits for us. So the Sahaba said, "O Messenger of Allah, we have lots of Quran about theology. We have lots of Quran about other things. Why don't you tell us some stories?" And so as a response, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Yusuf that wasn't just a story. It was the best of all stories, أحسن القصص. We need to take a short break. When we come back, we'll continue talking about the tafsir and the interpretation of this beautiful surah. Stay with us.
لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ
كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ
Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty. So is it logical to say all plastic surgeries are lawful in Islam to bring or to regain beauty? It is very misleading questions. Need a very accurate and firm answers. Let us set up the rules and principles to cover all plastic surgeries in Islamic law. How Islam does legalize niqab or veil factor in our modern life? Is it fair to suggest that it is more cultural than it is Islamic? I would rather to answer these questions by just suggesting very shocking fact about niqab. Are you ready for that? How Islam does legalize polygamy when Islam always says that respect natural instinct and natural feelings, and knowing that not a single woman does accept anyone to share her in her kingdom? All what you have said is true. But is there any difference between your natural instinct and your natural desires, or maybe between your interest or what you wish to have, or maybe your interest and other interest? Is it true that anything came after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam regarding this deen to be considered as a bid'ah, innovation? It's neither this nor that. It seems very well complicated and confusing to many Muslims, especially when it comes to the saying of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Wa kullu muhdathatin bid'ah," and Sayyidina Umar saying, "نعمت البدعة هذه." Let us set up the very comprehensive definition of bid'ah according to Islamic law.
لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ
كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Welcome back. So, in the previous episode and also in our previous section before we went to the break, we have basically laid out the foundations for understanding the context into which Surah Yusuf was revealed. Now, insha'Allah ta'ala, we will begin the actual tafsir or the actual discussion of Surah Yusuf. And insha'Allah ta'ala, what we're going to do is we're going to recite the verses in proper tajweed, the proper way they're supposed to be recited, piecemeal, bit by bit. And then insha'Allah ta'ala, we will explain each section and each segment as we go along. It would be very beneficial for the viewers if they were to take a Qur'an with a translation and follow along the recitation and also see the translation in their own mushafs, and inshallah ta'ala will also appear on your screens. But if you have the copy of the Qur'an with you, that would be very beneficial as well.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام را تلك آيات الكتاب المبين إنا أنزلناه قرآنا عربيا لعلكم تعقلون نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص بما أوحينا إليك هذا القرآن وإن كنت من قبله لمن الغافلين إذ قال يوسف لأبيه يا أبت إني رأيت أحد عشر كوكبا إني رأيت أحد عشر كوكبا والشمس والقمر رأيتهم لي ساجدين قال يا بني لا تقصص رؤياك على إخوتك فيكيدوا لك كيدا إن الشيطان للإنسان عدو مبين وكذلك يجتبيك ربك ويعلمك من تأويل الأحاديث ويتم نعمته عليك وعلى آل يعقوب كما أتمها على أبويك من قبل إبراهيم وإسحاق إِنَّ رَبَّكَ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ
So these were the first six ayat that we recited of Surah Yusuf. And we began obviously by reciting أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ And of course we began this because Allah commands us to begin any time we recite the Qur'an. Allah says in the Qur'an, فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنَ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ Any time you read the Qur'an, the first thing you should do is إِسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ Seek refuge in Allah from shaytan, the accursed. So we begin every single recitation by saying أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ Which means, I turn to Allah for refuge. I turn to Allah to seek help and protection. Allah is my protector. Allah is the one that is my refuge, my source of all serenity and peace. So I turn to Allah for refuge. From what? أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. from shaitan. And shaitan is the description of Iblis. Shaitan is the name that is given to Iblis. His proper name is Iblis. The name that he has is Iblis. Shaitan is his title or his description, and it means the one who has gone beyond the bounds, the one who has gone out of and above what he should be doing. This is shaitan. He has transgressed the bounds. Ar-Rajim means the accursed. Ar-Rajim means he is cursed by Allah. He is somebody who has been deprived of Allah's mercy. So before we begin understanding and reciting the Quran, the first thing that we have to do is we seek refuge in Allah from shaitan, the accursed. And the reason we do this is so that he does not cloud our minds up. He allows us to read this Quran and obtain the best guidance we can from it. I then moved on to the second thing that we need to say before beginning the Quran, and that is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And this is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that he would always say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim every time, especially when he started a surah. Every time he started a surah, he would say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, except for the ninth surah, Surah Tawbah. All the other surahs in the Quran would begin with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The meaning of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim basically means I begin this recitation by mentioning the name of Allah, the Merciful, the Extra Beneficent. The point of beginning by mentioning the name of Allah has many benefits. First and foremost, you remind yourself of why you're doing this deed. I begin by remembering Allah. I'm doing this for the sake of Allah. So we say Bismillah before we do any good deed, because we're supposed to be remembering Allah and doing this for the sake of Allah. Secondly, we seek Allah's help. Bismillah, i.e. I am turning to Allah for help. So after I have sought refuge in Allah, a'udhu billah, the next step is to seek help. So refuge means protection. Once you've sought protection, now you want help to become even more. Protection is one level. Higher level is actual help. So once we seek refuge, we then move on. And we say, in the name of Allah, I begin this recitation. In the name of Allah, I begin this eating. In the name of Allah, I begin this writing. Whatever you are doing, you say Bismillah. When you eat, you say Bismillah. When you write, you say Bismillah. When you enter the house, you say Bismillah. So you say, in the name of Allah, I begin whatever I am doing. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim are two of the names of Allah that are very common, and they occur many times in the Quran together. Ar-Rahman means the one who is merciful by nature. Allah Azza wa Jalla's nature is that He is merciful. And Ar-Rahim means the one who is merciful in His actions. Whatever actions Allah does, He is merciful in those actions. So every time we begin, we're supposed to say, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim. When we begin a surah, we're supposed to say, Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. But if we begin in the middle of the recitation, in the middle of a surah, here it is optional. If we want to say Bismillah, fine. And if we want to leave Bismillah and just say A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim and then jump into the surah, that is permissible as well. In other words, if you begin the beginning of a surah, you need to say Bismillah. But if you begin from the middle of a surah, then you don't have to say Bismillah. If you want to, you can say it. And if you don't, you may leave it and restrict yourself only to A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim. The first letters of the surah are Alif, Lam, Ra. And these letters give us a point to think about. We all know that many surahs in the Quran begin with letters. Alif, Lam, Mim, Hamim, Ain, Sin, Qaf, Taha, Noon, Yasin, Qaf, Noon. All of these surahs begin with specific letters. What is the meaning of these letters? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala use these letters? There are many, many opinions about why these letters are used. But the one that appears to have the greatest credible strength, and indeed only Allah knows best, is that Allah has used these letters as a means of indicating that the Quran is composed of the same letters that you have. It is composed of the same words that you use, and yet it is not like your speech or the speech of men. Even though it is in your language, even though it is used in your letters, still, it is not in the speech of men, it is the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And of the indications of this is that if you look at all of the beginning letters of the surahs, Hamim, Ain, Sin, Qaf, Taha, Noon, all of these letters, you compile them, they turn out to be 14 in number. And we know that the alphabet of Arabic has 28 letters. So 14 letters are used in the beginning of the surahs, and the entire alphabet is composed of 28 letters. It's as if Allah is saying, here is half. This is half the language. See if you can, with the other half, bring something similar to the Qur'an. So it is as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is proving the miraculous nature of the Qur'an through these letters. Allah says, Alif Lam Ra, tilka ayatul kitab al-mubin. One phenomenon that we notice, almost every single time Allah begins a surah with letters, the very next verse talks about the Qur'an itself. Yasin wal-Qur'an al-Hakim, Qaf wal-Qur'an al-Majid, Alif Lam Mim, Thalika al-Kitab. Every single surah that begins with these letters, the next verse talks about the Qur'an. And perhaps the reason for this is that these letters are meant to indicate the powerful nature of the Qur'an, the miraculous aspect of the Qur'an. Allah says, these are the book, these are the ayats, these are the verses of the clear book. So Allah mentions that the Qur'an is composed of ayat. And Allah in other verses mentions that the Qur'an is composed of surahs. So the differentiation of surahs and ayat is chosen by Allah Himself. Allah Himself mentions a surah is a chapter, an ayah is a verse in the chapter. Allah Himself says in one revelation, He says, this is a surah that we revealed. Suratun anzalnaha. In another chapter, in this one for example, Allah says, these are the ayat. So in this we understand that the surahs and ayat are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have come to the conclusion of today's episode. Inshallah ta'ala, in our next episode, we will continue talking about the explanation of the first few verses of Surah Yusuf. I hope to see you then. Until next time, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة.
لقد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب. قد كان في قصصهم عبرة لأولي الألباب ما كان حديثا يفترى ولكن تصديق الذي بين يديه وتفصيل كل شيء وهدى ورحمة لقوم يؤمنون.